Hello everyone, welcome back to today's video. My name is Brittany Simon, and in today's video we are going to review a talk Jordan Peterson did where he talked about borderline. And since I am diagnosed borderline, I decided to go ahead and go through this with you. As many of you guys know, I did listen to Jordan Peterson in the past and really disliked him when I was like an SJW. And then when I got a little bit healthier, went to therapy, got better, I revisited some of Jordan Peterson's work and actually found him to be quite insightful. Now, since I did get better, since I am in recovery, since I've been clean of symptoms or slash triggers episodes since October of 2019, I feel like I am in a really good and healthy place to review this video with a new set of eyes. So let's go ahead and do that together.
Tonight, I'd like to ask you about two different psychological disorders. The first being borderline personality disorder. And I was wondering, just like many young men have gravitated towards your lectures, do you think that there's something about this particular disorder that there's something about people with this particular disorder that might gravitate to your insights and your lectures?
Okay. So now I would say probably no to the second one, but I could comment more about borderline personality disorder. I think I have enough mental energy to do that tonight. So technically speaking, it's often considered the female variant of antisocial personality disorder. So it's classified in the domain of externalizing disorders, acting out disorders. And I think what happens, we don't understand borderline personality disorder very well. I mean, it's characterized by tremendous impulsivity, radical confusion of identity. And then this pattern of idealization of people with whom the person afflicted with the disorder is associating, with radical idealization of those people and then radical devaluation of them. And then there's another theme that sort of weaves along with it, which is the proclivity of people with borderline personality disorder to presume that they will be abandoned and then to act in a manner that makes such abandonment virtually certain. And so it's a very complicated disorder, but that, I think, gets at the crux of it.
Okay, wow. So this is actually really interesting for me. I do think his description of people with borderline personality disorder is pretty accurate. I also think it's interesting how much it correlates with what we know as narcissism. And that's interesting to me. But funny, the antisocial, I assume, is sociopathy more so than narcissism. But I find a great correlation between narcissism and borderline more than I do sociopathy and borderline. But of course, I'm not an educated person. I dropped out of college. The whole point of my channel is not to come from a place of academia, because I think based off of the statistical probability of you going to college and graduating in a degree in psychology, most of us are going to not have that. And we're going to have family members or ourselves to sort of understand better. And I think to understand each other better, we should be reading more and consuming more. Documentaries and video essays are great, but personally, I think books are much better teachers. So if you can, audiobook or written book, either way, very, very much recommend. I think for me as a borderline, hearing this description come from Jordan Peterson, someone who I now actually do really respect and I think is insightful, it can sound hurtful. But to be honest, I feel unscathed. At this point in my recovery, I beat the demons. I am living proof that you can get better. And I only knew I could get better because I met someone else who had gotten better. And then, of course, I learned about Marsha Linehan and she had gotten better. DBT saved my life. So I know some people might want to get defensive and feel offended, but I'm telling you right now, it is so comforting to know that that might have been a descriptor of me at one point, and now it is not. So my borderline was diagnosed formally in 2017. At the end of 2016, I was going to therapy. I had been in a really bad place at that point, surrounded by Seattle in its different culture from the way that I was raised and could operate. I was feeling no peace in those communities and I was frustrated. I ended up going to therapy because I had lost my job, and I had never lost my job before. I am a incredibly hard worker. I like to work. I love my jobs. I love creating the world in which I want to exist and flourish in, and how I make my money. I love everything about that. My dad's an immigrant. He owns his own business. I love it. It's in my blood. So when I lost my job and I had created such a good reputation for myself, I had realized, okay, you had hit a dead end, a real dead end. I'm a person who, though I have suffered from mental illness and struggled, once I really took off in my 20s and started having jobs, I never not worked. I never not paid my bills. I never not paid rent. So this is a very, it was my way of knowing that I was okay, because I hadn't gone to therapy up until my late 20s. And it was a way to justify sort of how a mess my life was. Well, at least I could maintain work, right? And then I realized once I couldn't maintain work, oh, girl, you hit a dead end. So I ended up going to therapy, and it was very frustrating. And I did have a therapist who was not great. And then I had a therapist who was. And this therapist diagnosed me as borderline personality disorder. I did not know what that was at the time. And when I looked it up, the internet had scared me. And then at the same time, I was super relieved I'd been diagnosed. I had an answer for the mania and the insanity. And you know what? To be honest, some of those descriptors fit me so perfect, it makes me feel seen. Now, I understand, though, it can seem like an uphill battle, something that won't get done, because you meet a lot of therapists who say things like, ooh, a borderline, or maybe borderlines can't be helped. And for me, I radically embrace Marshall Linehan's DBT as the reason for my success, as well as my past of being very well read.
One of the things that's interesting about people with borderline personality disorder, in my experience, is that they're often quite intelligent, and you see in the person with borderline personality disorder something like the waste or the squandering of tremendous potential. They seem capable of thinking through the nature of their problems and analyzing them and discussing it, but not capable whatsoever of implementing any solutions. The other thing that seems to be characteristic of borderline people with borderline personality disorder is that they remind me very much of people who are 2 years old, and in some manner. Like, people with borderline personality disorder can have temper tantrums. In fact, they often do. And, you know, now and then you see a temper tantrum, and they're usually thrown by two-year-olds, right? Most people grow out of temper tantrums by the time they're about three. They're very rare at four, which is a good thing, because if they're still there at four, that is not a good diagnostic predictor. The funny thing is, when a two-year-old does it, it's like it's, you know, it's a little off-putting. But when an adult does it, it's completely bloody terrifying. And it happens very frequently with borderlines. And so I would also say, to some degree, they didn't get properly socialized between that critical period of development between 2 and 4. And you see the same thing with adult males who grow up to be antisocial. Because a large proportion of adult males who grow up to be antisocial are aggressive as children, as two-year-olds. And so there's a small proportion of two-year-olds who are quite aggressive. They'll kick and hit and bite and steal. If you put them with other two-year-olds, it's about 5% of the males, smaller fraction of the females. But most of them are socialized by the time they're four. But there's a small percentage who aren't, and they tend to stay antisocial, and they tend to turn into long-term offenders.
I remember distinctly becoming a person over time who would have panic attacks in public, and I couldn't recognize myself anymore. I remember thinking, what am I doing? I had screamed as a teenager on the top of my lungs, had moments with my parents where I was like, you know, slammed doors and left. So for me, you know, I'm used to having a lot of mental illness and challenges around me, and especially coming from my own brain, I can recognize that if this is how, you know, something was wrong, I could recognize that something was wrong with me. I think what ultimately led to me being better was introspection. A lot of people I meet don't even know who they are, what they're doing, and I was obsessed with that. When I started having panic attacks in public, I was mortified. I did not recognize myself. I didn't understand who this person was. I didn't understand what I was doing. And while it was happening, it felt so valid. It felt so reasonable. I had so many good reasons to have a panic attack in public, or to feel like I was allowed to lose control. And eventually I realized, this isn't normal. You need to fix your brain. Something is wrong. Normal people don't have panic attacks in public. And when I say normal, I just mean healthy. I just mean someone who understands. Because if we, you know, we're so busy in America normalizing mental illness when we should really be normalizing recovery. You should get help. It is very common to struggle with a mental illness. You should feel that it is common to get help. But you should not feel validated in your mental illness as a part of your identity, to the point where getting better makes you feel betrayed. That is a huge problem with borderline, is the identity aspect. This was such a struggle for me. There are so many different versions of myself inside of me. I had to work so hard to find my core. Even this Brittany right now, dressed like this, this is BDSM Brittany. This is like feeling saucy Brittany. This isn't my default Brittany. Default Brittany wears sweatpants and hoodies. Like, default Brittany watches anime and gets stoned. Default Brittany is reading books and being just just like alone or with her family or with, you know what I mean? I have parts of myself though that I love to go out and explore. YouTube allows me the opportunity to explore so many parts of myself, but the average person isn't going to have this life. I built this life for myself. I work countless hours and countless days to do this full time and I make it work, but I couldn't have made it work if I wasn't me. And so much of who I am is what I have consumed, the lives I've lived, the marches I have been in, the people I have interacted with. So much of my life is being curious. And I think what happens, what Jordan Peterson is talking about when he says people know what to do, but they don't know how to implement it. I am a stubborn, stubborn person. And the only thing I thought of the whole time is, how do I make this happen? All I care about is goals. If you looked at my Myers-Briggs results, you'd see I'm a commander. I'm a person who, for me, it's about getting whatever we need done, done. No matter what it takes, just figure it out. And so because that's how my brain works, and it works so perfectly that way, I think it contributed to me healing. I think it made it so I was determined, just out of the sheer stubborn rebelliousness to prove people wrong, that I could be successful or that I could be healthy or that I could get back into shape or that I could get married or have kids or be a mother. Like, I have all of these value systems that actually keep me going. My value system tells me that I cannot be a mother that is a mental wreck because I know too much and I know better and I know better than the past generations, and I don't blame people for having kids when they're mentally ill. But because I know better, if I did that, I would be a bad person because I know better, which my value system tells me, because you know better, I expect you to do better. And I really do know better. It's not something that I just casually believe. I truly believe that my job before I became a mother, before I become a mother, is to secure and keep a consistent positive mental health. And that is hard. That is so hard. And I've only been good for about a year and a half. So I still haven't even reached my 2-year mark, but I am hoping as I go forward, I'm able to keep my triggers down. I'm able to ignore negative thoughts, feelings, and ideations. And I'm going to wake up happy every day like I feel. I do feel very joyous. But getting here was not easy. And I think a lot of it was my determination because I come from a background where they don't validate mental health. My parents, even after I got diagnosed, they like had a hard time. I think they still have a hard time admitting that I got diagnosed. I have friends and family that tell me, oh, you don't seem like you have borderline. Are you sure they didn't misdiagnose you? But the truth is that only certain people have ever seen me triggered or in an episode consistently and in a personal way, right? And then the only other people that I've ever exposed myself to was the internet, because I was a trying to be a YouTuber at a time when I was like really mentally ill, and I would post videos and then quickly take them down because after I got out of the episode, I'd be like, what are you doing? Like, this is not normal. Take this down. But in those moments, it feels so valid. And yes, I will make a video about my borderline journey. I've decided that I think it's time to talk about it and talk about it in a way that with like visual proof of like my life has been documented, and a lot of those videos are private, but I have them. I have documentations of Brittany looking manic, Brittany being crazy, Brittany being suicidal, and I look at that girl and I don't even recognize her anymore, but she did exist, and it was very hard for her to become this person, but she did it, and it wasn't alone. I mean, I had to go to therapy on my own. I had to make the decision to save myself on my own. I had to do that, and I think Jordan Peterson's right. It's very hard to do that part. But I also had a reason to live. I had friends and family and inner circle and people who loved me. And I had very solid people in my life who told me there was more, who kept me alive by telling me, I know you think you figured it out, but there's a little bit more. And I found that more. And that's what I'm still alive for today, is like, I love being this happy. And I just want to keep learning about existence and enjoying my time on Earth. Now, there's a second video Jordan Peterson has that says, how do you help someone with borderline personality disorder? I want to watch that with you guys as well.
So you said on a recent live stream that you didn't have enough energy to answer this question, but you said it was intriguing. So I was wondering if you had the energy to answer how someone might help someone that has borderline personality disorder.
By example. By example, let's not take borderline personality disorder precisely as the example, okay? I understand the question. The question to some degree is, how do you help someone that's lost? And the answer to that is, if they aren't willing to not be lost, you cannot help them. And I would also say that as a clinician. You see, I mean, it's a statement that's informed, I would say, by my mythological knowledge, but also by straight clinical wisdom, not mine particularly. I mean, one of the things that Carl Rogers pointed out was that there were necessary preconditions for entering into a therapeutic relationship. And that would be really any relationship where the mutual flourishing of the two people involved was the paramount goal. And one of the preconditions was that both people had to want that to happen. And Rogers believed he didn't know how to get the horse to drink once you had brought it to the water. And I've thought about that a lot, because when people are really lost, sometimes they're so lost that they can't be found. And I think the only thing that you can do in a situation like that is get your life together and manifest the reality of an alternative mode of being. That's what you've got. And so that's the only way I know of to solve an intractable problem.
The thing that's interesting about this is that I completely agree. My therapist said, I can't save the world. I have to, you know, I have to save myself, and that's all I have to save. And if we all saved ourselves, the world would be a better place. But mostly humans just kind of blame everyone else. And in the darkest, deepest parts of my depression, anxiety, and borderline PTSD and all the things I was suffering from, I did not and could not believe that I had the ability on my own to save myself. And you really don't, but you do. It's weird. It's a hard conversation to have. We need people in our lives to set an example, right? Live as an example. I had that. I had some people in my life that were examples of this is what healthy people are living like. And so I knew what a goal was of at least I could get here, right? And so I had that positive role model. And in turn, I had somebody in my life who I do believe suffers from BPD, but I have not gotten a formal diagnosis for them because they're not therapy believers. But one of the things that's interesting about them is that our relationship got healthier and better when I started to use DBT steps with them in conversation. I'd be like, oh, you know what I learned in DBT today? Or I learned in DBT. It's like, oh, you know what I learned? And I gave them steps in a way that I know, you know, some people might call it manipulative. But when you see someone suffering and I know that they're too stubborn to hear you straight up tell them you have the power to get better, right? Sometimes you have to go and show them with your life. Like I told them the ways it benefited me and they could see that I had gotten better. And our relationship over the last few years has been amazing, amazingly better. I know some of us want to save the people in our lives and I just told you can't. And I'm trying to tell you that there is a difference between me setting an example and you trying to actively save somebody you can't. And I think this is the hardest part to understand. I always talk about the Black Jewel trilogy because it's one of my favorite fantasy series. And in it, there's a place that people sink to, this vortex of depression and just like lostness of mental illness. And people can't go down and save them. They can only remind them that they're above the surface. The person has to climb their way out. And that's what mental illness is like. And I know it's hard to believe that you have the power right now, especially while you're manic or doing all of these things. But I'm telling you, it all comes down to you. And because I did it, I know you can do it. Because someone else did it, I know you can do it. I know I can do it. I had living proof around me that people could get better. I, like DBT, like Marshall Linehan's brain is amazing. And I don't know why. I don't know why it worked so well for me. I don't know how it worked so quickly. But it completely changed my life.
The reason that I went down that direction with regards to borderline personality disorders, because it's one of the most serious of the personality disorders, very difficult to treat. And so I'll generalize from that to situations that are very difficult to deal with. And, you know, there's a statement too, and this has nothing to do with borderline personality disorder per se. There's a statement in the New Testament that's really vicious. In fact, there's a number of them, but this is a particularly vicious one. And that is, don't cast pearls before swine. And what that means is, if you're trying to help and it doesn't work, then stop helping. Mm-hmm. It's not helping, mm-hmm. right? It may be just wasting your time. Mm-hmm. It might be making things worse. Mm-hmm. No, if you're offering something and it's not taken, then perhaps you should be offering it somewhere else. And sometimes, if you offer a hand and the person won't take it, you have to stop offering the hand. And sometimes that means in people's lives, for example, that they have to leave their family members behind.
So this is so good. First of all, obviously being raised very Catholic and being a person who's read the Bible, who has a copy of the Bible, who continues to read the Bible on occasion, I like these stories. I like fables and fairy tales and lore. I like virtue stories. I like things with, you know, I like ancient religions. I like ancient civilizations because they often teach through story. I think Americans have completely lost an ability to tell a story. So the thing that's significant to me with this particular clip is how powerful it is to walk away and how helping is sometimes enabling. When I was in Seattle, so much enabling was happening. Mental illness, in order to care for it, they rejected the conservative version of no one's mentally ill, you're all just like victims, right? Into everyone has a mental illness slash everyone's mental illness is valid slash emotions are valid slash all of these things. And it's two sides of the same coin, right? We all really know mental illness exists. We've seen it in our family and friends. We've seen addiction happen. We've seen narcissism. We've seen borderline. We've seen these things. We can pretend all we want that it's easy and simple, but it isn't. And so what we have to do is sometimes walk away from the people we love the most to make it clear to them that we can't enable them. And at the same time, we slightly can enable people in our lives in order just to keep them alive long enough. Or sometimes, like I said in the narcissist episode of my podcast, sometimes you have to make it clear, I am open, but I have boundaries. Here's my picket fence in front of my house. I'm open, but I have boundaries. Finding that balance was so hard for me. It's hard for me right now as a YouTuber. Do you know how many of you reach out to me with the most moving stories and I want to help you, I want to save you, but I can't? One of the reasons when people approach me on the Skype calls, which I love to do, links down below for my Patreon. If you guys want to talk to me, that's great. You want to help, you want me to help you on your journey of being like a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If you follow my levels philosophy and you know that there is proof that my life has changed and switched because of the way I redesigned how my brain processes information, and I think I can help you with that as not a therapist, but a human, like a person to person. If you come to me and you tell me your story and I tell you that I can't just give you the answer, it's because I can't. Truth has to be discovered. I cannot just tell you what to do. Your brain will not listen. You've spent years building self-defense mechanisms, making sure your walls are up, making sure you don't trust anyone or believe anyone. Your bias is there to protect you, but it's also there to stunt you. And so you need to fight these things to get better. But no one, not one person, not one affiliation, not one ethnicity, not one background has ever been that different to me, because ultimately humans want to love and be loved. Ultimately, the way we see the world is through the lens of the information we have in our noggins. And if your limitation, you know, if your information is limited, you're going to struggle to really understand the vast options you have in existence. This is not all there is. Jordan Peterson, YouTube feminists, SJWs, you know, PewDiePie, all the controversies on YouTube all the time, canceling people, Hollywood, Seth Rogen, James Franco, all of these things are the most superficial part of our existences that, yes, can mean deeper things for different people at different times. But ultimately, how you view the world and the existence you have is going to help you with your mental health. It completely changed mine. The ego deaths, the experiences I had, the goals of meditation completely humbled me in times when I felt like I had the right to be the most arrogant. And so I resonate with this. I resonate with this idea that sometimes we have to let go of the people we love. And that includes our past selves. That includes our depressed self, our anxiety self. I say this all the time on my channel. I have a romantic view of parts of my depression. Not all of it, but there was a big chunk of it that was romantic. Sometimes I miss mania. Sometimes I miss being crazy. And then I remember how sad and awful and lonely it was. And I remember that that dark place looks good right now because it's been a long time. And like a drug or a bad friend or something that is a vice for you, it only looks good because you have forgotten exactly how much it hurt. So what I do is I have my life documented. I go back and watch YouTube videos, which are insanely embarrassing to me now. I go back and read my journals that make me cringe so hard. I almost can't finish a passage because of that Brittany's mindset, her belief that her nihilistic, hedonistic pastime was all there could ever be of life was so stunted. I had so much more growing to do, and I still have more growing to do now. I'm just better equipped to handle the constant changes and possible horrifying situations life might find me in. And this, I think, is what ultimately Jordan Peterson's talking about with all of his work. Be prepared. Clean your room. I make my bed every day. My mom always told me growing up, make your bed, you'll notice a difference. And I didn't believe her until basically recently. I'm 32, and I basically only in the last 2 years started making my bed, and only until recently consistently cleaned my room and made sure my space was a positive space. Every time I entered my room, I wanted it to be something I could breathe in, I could lay in, I could do yoga in, I could relax in, I could meditate in, I could work in. And that is just, I never knew it would take me so long to figure it out. So again, the solutions might seem simple. Clean your room. How hard is that? But doing it is definitely hard. It's definitely hard. And that ultimately is life. Life is ultimately hard because even doing the most simple thing is difficult. That's why when I hear young activists say things like, it's not that hard, do this, it's not that hard, I know they haven't lived a life that is truly difficult. Because even the most simple task is difficult for some of us. Thank you for watching. I hope you have the most fantastic day. Please check out my Patreon. Check out Jordan Peterson's work. And remember that he's a man who's lived a life and has the information that he has in his mind. Don't judge a person by their audience. Judge a person by their work. Don't learn about philosophy through video essays or other people's opinions. Read the work of the philosopher. You know what it's like to have your image tarnished. You should know what it's like. And if you don't, it's horrible. Let me tell you, someone else going along telling people what you think is awful. Thank you guys for watching. Have a great day. I hope I see you next video. Bye.